Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. And actually, I'll tell you a little bit about where I'm from, what Reglab is about. But basically, Reglab is about distributing new knowledge on how we can create more regional growth and regional development. And today, I will present the main findings and conclusions from our latest study, which actually is just about today's theme, called the study approaches to growth, and seems very suitable for today's theme. And but unfortunately, well, this is the first time I'm doing a presentation in English, so I'm excited to see how it goes, and I was very interested to hear from our international guests today to hear from you. What are your experiences? Are they similar to what we have found in this study? But also, please bear in mind that not all the figures are yet translated into English. But we will have a translation of at least the main conclusions of the report later this year, so then we can distribute to all of you later on. Right, what we have looked at in this project I'm going to tell you about today. Oh yeah, please, before I start, please interrupt me if you have any questions along the way, some clarifications, to try to answer that along the way. But what we have tried to study in this project is basically what are the critical factors when SMEs are collaborating with knowledge institutions? What are the critical success factors? What determines if the project really succeed in creating new value for the companies compared to other projects where they might not be so successful? And it's important to say that in this project we only primarily looked at the value adding for the companies. Of course, being a collaboration, it's also important, of course, that the knowledge institutions, universities, university colleges, etc., also get some value and benefit out of a collaboration project, naturally. But that's not the scope and focus for this project. Right. But before I go into to tell you more about the study and the conclusion, just two words about what is Reglab for an organization. Well, basically, we are sort of a network organization where we're focusing on how can we stimulate regional development and innovation policies in Denmark. And we are member-based, so our members are all actors working with regional development and innovation development, meaning both on the policy level, that being ministries, regions, municipalities. And of course, we are here in Region Zealand, we have also a member of Reglab. But then we also have the actors that actually are collaborating with the SMEs. So we also have, as our members, many of the universities in Denmark, university colleges. I can't actually remember if Absalon is a member. Do you know that? You're from Absalon? Yeah. Great. And also the local business promotion supporters are also members at our organization. And what do? Well, we try to make some new studies, new knowledge, but also collect what others, clever people around Europe have find out about how can we stimulate regional development, what kind of policies and initiatives could be best practice, and then we try to disseminate it along around our members at seminars, conferences, workshops, and other kinds of networking activities. And we are financed by our members, and we are an independent organization. Yes? A little bit about the output. We have made several reports from this study that I'm going to tell you about. The main report is a very thick and heavy one, so I cannot bring it here, but it has collects a lot of cases, specific collaboration cases, Then we have made a summary, which is there's a leaflet over there where you can find the summary of the conclusions and reports. And then we also looked into some international cases on what can we see could be best practice around Northern Europe in initiatives and programs that are stimulating and enhancing knowledge collaboration. If I have time at the end of this presentation, I can tell you a little bit about some international best practices. Do see if there's time for that. Right. And we are fortunate that this report that we have made, this study, that we have a lot of our members have actually been active supporting this study and analysis, both from the Ministry of Education and Research and from all the regions in Denmark and also other actors and municipalities. So we are happy about that. So this means that this subject is something that's really interesting and important for a lot of our members. From different perspectives. Right, our starting point is basically, of course, there's already been doing a lot of research and studies about knowledge collaboration, what is the benefit of that, and what is the impact of that. So we know already that companies that are collaborating with knowledge institutions, they in general tend to perform better when it comes to productivity, growth, and innovation capacity. So we know that it's a good idea to involve companies in knowledge collaboration. And we can also see, albeit a very slow growth in the numbers, in the share of companies participating in knowledge collaboration. But still, you can see it's only about 10% of the innovative companies that are actually collaborating. So there should be a huge potential for more collaboration, getting more companies involved in knowledge collaboration. So, and of course we know that there are a lot of barriers, especially for SMEs, when it comes to put forward the resources. They have, of course, limited access to resources, both within the company and both when it comes to the employees, the skills and the financial resources that it takes to enter into at least some more demanding collaborations. So we also know quite a lot about the barriers already. But what we found that we didn't know that much about is actually what are the actual critical success factors that separating like a collaboration project that succeed in creating new value for the company compared to projects that are not so successful. So this is what we decided to look more into in this project. And here's the framework of the project and the analysis. Unfortunately, it's in Danish, so I'll explain it. I guess you can figure out that on the right side we have the companies. On the left side, we have the different knowledge institutions that companies can collaborate with. Universities, university colleges, vocational schools, technological institutes, hospitals, etc. And then in the middle, we have different knowledge bridges or types of collaboration. It could be innovation projects, it could be student projects, it could be knowledge service that you actually pay for. It could be different kind of training concepts, and it could be entrepreneurship. So we're looking into different types of knowledge bridges in this project. And finally, at the bottom, we have what we call the knowledge mediators, some kind of facilitators that can support the process and the collaboration along the way, which are also important. I'll come back to those, to the role of these knowledge mediators. And then, our approach is to take the qualitative approach, meaning that we have studied a lot of in-depth cases, around 50 collaboration cases between SMEs and different knowledge institutions. And from that we try to extract what are the general factors and that has been important and crucial for the success of the collaboration, and also how did they overcome the obstacles, the barriers, the challenges that were along the way. And we are fortunate that one of our cases will present after me. Any group is one of the cases in the report, so then you get a very specific case. Right. Another attention point is that which we noticed and from this project is that companies do have quite a lot of different objectives for actually entering into knowledge collaboration. Of course, the most important and the most usual one is, of course, that they want to have solved the specific challenge or problem or get a new solution and something that they can create development and growth, concrete growth and something. So of course, that's number one. But apart from that direct growth objective, there are also a number of other objectives we found that were reasons for companies to collaborations, and some of them are listed here. It could be that they wanted just simply to clarify a new technology is appearing, and the company just wanted to find out, is this a technology something that could be interesting for us? So they made a smaller project, maybe just discover what is the potential of this technology. It could also be a useful result for the company that actually they conclusion was, no, this technology is not good enough, then they will have to waste more energy on this technology. Another objective is could be to recruit new employees, students, to have a small project with them, and then afterwards maybe they will hire them if the collaboration has been successful. Some companies get a good branding of collaborating with a university, and it could also be if they want to have to have a new, implement a new culture, maybe a more innovative culture among the members, among the employees in the company. They could have some external people coming in and trying to come up with new ideas for the company. And of course, network building is also an important objective. Right, just to give you the main conclusions right now, and then I'll go more in detail with them. As already mentioned, there should be a great potential for more collaboration in terms of numbers of collaboration, but also, in particular, also that should also be a potential for getting more successful collaborations because getting more value out of those collaborations that's been initiated. So what we see is that even among those 50 best practice cases we have here, they also have quite a lot of challenges facing along the way in the projects. And then, very important conclusion is that when we looked across all these 50 cases, they were all of them very good at actually doing the actual, carrying out the actual project during the, what we call it, the during phase in the project time. But what they were not so paid so much attention to was actually the preparation in the pre-phase and how they implemented the results of the project in the after phase. So the pre and after phase is something that is really important to pay more attention to, and that was something that we found that there is still room for improvement in general aspects of collaboration. And then we more specifically identified 14 success criteria for successful collaboration, knowledge collaboration. And that's quite a lot. I'll go into detail below. And then the final main conclusion is that the whole ecosystem of different actors, innovation, and the business support actors, and the schemes, funding schemes that can support the knowledge collaboration is also very important in many of the cases that we have examined. Right, so the simple model of creating a successful knowledge collaboration is, not surprisingly, that you have these three simple phases: the before phase or the pre-phase, the during phase of a project, and then the after phase. That's very basic and simple. Of course, we didn't need to pay a lot of money to consultants to get that result. But what is more interesting is the actual concrete success criteria or factors that we identified in the projects. And those 14 are listed there. And those 14 we have put in some guidelines where they have been more, where we have elaborated more on them and actually come up with some really hands-on tips for how can you actually go through all these criteria when you're starting a project. And of course, it's important to say that not all these 14 criteria are necessarily important in has the same importance in all types of projects. You could say that smaller, simple projects, they're not that important. It may be the more obvious that you will come around all these points, but in the more bigger, long-term, and more complicated projects with many partners, then I think it would be very important to go through all these 14 criteria when you start the project and carry out the project. And as you can see, as I mentioned before, that the before phase where you actually plan and structure the whole project and plan everything and design the project is really important, and that's also, you can see there's 6 of the 14 factors are actually in the before phase. I will just tell you a little bit about those that we have, those factors that we have experienced were also a challenge, even this, in these successful cases that we have been looked at in this project. In the pre-phase, well, it should be obvious that, of course, when you want to develop a new solution, that you, of course you assess what are the needs for this new solution. But in many of these cases, we actually found that, well, they had made some kind of assessment of the needs, but they were not, it was not a very systematic assessment. So they were very, they were usually unstructured. Of course, we could find some good cases where it was really systematic, but looking across all these 50 cases, there was room for improvement in how they assessed the needs. Also in how they assessed the cost-benefit analysis, what was the business case, could they actually earn money on this, this new solution? One thing is if there's a need for it, but another thing is can they actually develop a solution that we can earn money on? That was also something that not everybody had done in a very systematic way. Also, to clarify, do we have the necessary resources within the company to actually carry out this project? We have the capacity, the knowledge, the skills were also something that could be improved. And then the design of the project was sometimes not very flexible designed, and maybe that was also could also be in part due to how different program schemes are structured. That could be a challenge in terms of how flexible you can make your project design. And then in the after phase, well, basically there were not enough focus on how should we implement and create actual value out of this the results of these projects. That was something that typically was left over to the companies to do it on their own when the project was finished. And some of the companies which were not very experienced in these types kind of knowledge collaboration could have challenges in actually translating the knowledge they have received into a real commercialization. Yes? What happened here? I think that is. Right. And then looking at some of the successful initiatives that the companies were on these projects were actually implementing in order to avoid these challenges I showed you before. Here are some examples of some successful concepts to get the results in an efficient way. And these lists are in the pre and the during phases. Of course, as an answer of having an sufficiently needed assessment, of course, could be to involve the end users in the need assessments, so workshop camps or field observations. And another important thing is that the knowledge partner in the project or facilitator should have initial meetings with companies to about the challenges and ambitions and how knowledge collaboration can contribute to the company. Proactive facilitators strongly involved throughout the process could follow up and provide feedback to the partners. Flexible workshop concepts, that was something we saw in particular when it comes to when the theme was about training and skill development, then there were some successful cases about they could use some flexible workshop concepts that could be tailor-made along the project. And in the after phase, it's very important that the sparring and the collaboration doesn't stop at once, but that the knowledge partner also continue in having contact to the company, so there will be a sliding transition from project to implementation. Could also be, in some cases, we saw that the business support system could be involved in the last phase, so they could help with developing a go-to-market strategy for the company. And we saw that a successful way was to recruit some of the participants in the project. For instance, if it was the students, so they could actually be recruited to the company and also help in implementing the results of the project. And some in some cases, the collaboration also continued after the project finished, and the company could use the university or the university college as a sort of an external R&D department for the further development and commercialization. Right, and some of the main recommendations. Well, when it comes to SMEs, well, we also looked at SMEs that did not have really previous experience in collaborating with knowledge institutions. Of course, they were the most challenged companies because they didn't have the experience. So one way to deal with these challenges could be that these unexperienced SMEs start with some smaller and more practical collaboration projects. It could be, for instance, with the students. It could be more practical projects with the vocational colleges instead of maybe starting with the university. And it could also, another way could be to participate in clusters or innovation networks where the companies are able to meet the different knowledge institutions and try to get to know them and maybe create some kind of understanding of what can they actually contribute with and create some trust before they enter into a real project. And what we also saw was that these SMEs without previous experience could really benefit from having from having support from a matchmaker or facilitator. And that's something that we developed a bit further in the project, that an external facilitator can really play an important role in helping the project becoming successful. Because they can act as a neutral third party who can help in both the pre, during, and after phase with a lot of different things. In the first instance, finding the right collaboration partners through matchmaking, helping clarify the internal capacity in the company, create a trustworthy foundation for collaboration between the different partners, and also to, along the project, ensure focus and momentum in the project, and ensure that the knowledge created could be translated into the needs of the company. And also, finally, in the after phase, support the road to commercialization.
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
What would be the optimal setup for the facilitator? Because I know many universities have tried to establish internal organizations in
yeah.
that role, but
yeah.
It's not always the best way to do it. So where would the facilitator be organized?
That's a good question, and what we saw is that there's not just one answer, because it really depends on, I would say, at least the skills of the facilitator, and also if the facilitator, if it's a company, if there's created already some kind of trust and understanding between the facilitator and the company. So we have successful examples of facilitators, actually both from universities and also from the local business support actors, and also from clusters. So it could be organized in different ways. Okay. It's not just one way, but it very much depends on, yeah, the skills of the facilitator. So we have examples of it can be organized in different ways. Right, and we also try to make some recommendations. What have the implications for policy making of these conclusions that we made in this study? And the first one is that it's really important that when policymakers are creating programs, that they also bear in mind that the pre-phase of the project, the preparation phase, is extremely important, and thus there should also be some kind of time and maybe also resources for that, maybe in the sense of in the form of the money for pre-projects or something like that. So you can so the partners can really prepare the project in an efficient and professional way. Secondly, apply a matchmaking function, because many SMEs don't really know where can I find the most relevant knowledge, where is the most relevant researchers or teachers that can help me. So this is also very important part of the pre phases, that looking for the most the right collaboration partners. For that we need some kind of matching function. Thirdly, it's very important that the program allow some kind of flexibility in the projects they support, because as we all know, the world is changing and the conditions of a project is changing while it continues and are developing. So there needs to be room for flexibility to adjust along the way. Also maybe to include new partners if that's relevant along the way. Number four is also, of course, we all know that we all make evaluations of our programs, but what we also need to do is systematically ask all the individual companies participating in the projects, and not just about, well, one thing is about did they achieve what they wanted in this project, but also what are the challenges now for actually taking this the results to the next step, to actually commercialize them and try to make money from them. And this should be done both just maybe when the project has finished, but also a while later on, maybe after 3 or 6 months, to see if the results are actually being implemented and creating value. And finally, providing these, as I've been mentioning, providing opportunities for ongoing facilitation throughout the project, which could be done by strengthening the use of knowledge mediators. This is very important for SMEs, especially for SMEs without much experience in knowledge collaboration.
Can I ask
something? Yeah.
I'm just curious about this one, because mm-hmm. I think it's very interesting focus point. Have you got any feedback from the people who are sitting and administrating these programs and projects? Because these are all challenging, I would say.
What we've heard is that, for instance, if you go for the EU structural funds, some of these points can be challenging in actually implementing, at least in that. In a very radical way, maybe you can implement elements of it, but we were told that they cannot really provide money for the after phase, really, in the structural funds. But then maybe the idea could be to use some other resources in the after phase, like the local business support system, so you can maybe try to combine different actors and resources, funding, if you want to do the whole pre, during, after phase. That could at least be one thing. I know in region, what are they called? They're called region central Denmark, as they call it in English, which are planned. They actually have made some programs where they tried to put in both have the role of the facilitator included in the programs, and also try to at least do some matchmaking within the branch. So it's called, the program is called Shortcut to Knowledge. So I think they've also described it a little bit in the book. Yeah. More questions for this? I don't know if time is running now.
Yeah, we are just about scheduled, and we will be able to return to you in the panel debate shortly. I mean, more the discussion point, but of course, if there are any, you know, short clarifying question or something you've been missing, we can take that. But otherwise, we will meet Morten in just half an hour more, sitting here, preparing to get, discuss all the feedback. Thank you very much, Morten.